Welcome and thank you for viewing this video on how to use the guide for improving pedestrian safety at uncontrolled crossing locations to select pedestrian countermeasures. After watching this video, you should be able to describe the purpose of the guide, explain how to use the guide, apply the process in the guide to select appropriate countermeasures to improve pedestrian safety at uncontrolled locations, and find more information in several online resources. You can watch the entire video from start to finish or use the table of contents featured on the left to skip ahead to specific sections. This section describes the purpose of the guide and introduces pedestrian safety at uncontrolled crossing locations. The guide can help you to identify, understand, and consider countermeasures to address pedestrian safety at uncontrolled pedestrian crossing locations. Following the process in the guide, you can develop a list of possible countermeasure options based on road conditions, crash contributing factors, and pedestrian safety issues. By fully considering all potential pedestrian safety countermeasures for an uncontrolled crossing, you can improve safety for pedestrians of all ages. An uncontrolled pedestrian crossing occurs where sidewalks or designated walkways intersect a roadway at a location where no traffic control is present. An uncontrolled crossing can be at an intersection or mid-block location, as shown here. Mid-block crossings are a prime opportunity for pedestrian safety countermeasures. In 2018, around 74% of fatal pedestrian crashes occurred at mid-block locations. This section describes how to use the guide to select appropriate countermeasures for uncontrolled pedestrian crossing locations. The guide provides a 6-step process to help select countermeasures at uncontrolled crossing locations. Step 1, collect data and engage the public. 2, inventory conditions and prioritize locations. 3, analyze crash types and safety issues. 4, select countermeasures. 5, consult design installations and resources, and 6, identify opportunities and monitor outcomes. This video provides a brief overview of each step and then focuses on step 4, select countermeasures. Step 1, collect data and engage the public, allows you to understand and describe broad existing pedestrian safety trends and engage stakeholders. As a first step, you would collect pedestrian crash data to understand potential crash patterns related to specific behaviors and environmental conditions. You can map crash locations to visualize the geographic dispersion of crashes. You can also review existing plans for safety statistics and locations previously identified for safety improvements. Evaluating existing pedestrian accommodation policies will inform you on how pedestrian improvements are currently incorporated into projects and allow you to consider potential improvements to the policy. Initiating a pedestrian safety action plan provides a formal process with which to engage the community and identify priority locations. Click on the link to find more information about creating a pedestrian safety action plan. If a less formal process is preferred, you can document public comments about safety concerns or conduct a walkability audit to identify locations generally considered as less safe for crossing pedestrians. In step 2, inventory conditions and prioritize locations. You would document field conditions to prioritize crossing locations. Pedestrian crossings should be inventoried and classified as either uncontrolled or controlled locations. Documenting pedestrian volumes and road user behavior at the crossings provides valuable information for countermeasure selection. Roadway characteristics near the crossings should be inventoried as well. It is a best practice to digitize this information, including traffic controls and conditions. After inventorying crossings, you can analyze the data to identify and prioritize high-risk crossing locations through crash cluster or systemic analysis. Step 3 guides you in summarizing pedestrian crash types and observe traffic safety issues in previously identified areas of concern. In locations where there is documented crash history, diagramming crashes can help you identify pedestrian crash trends by visualizing crash locations and other crash details, such as time of day, weather conditions, and more. You should consider an array of behavior, environmental, and roadway conditions when identifying crash contributing factors. Examples include driver yielding behavior, adjacent land use, and vehicle speed. You can also classify crashes based on the typology described by the Pedestrian Safety Guide and Countermeasure Selection System, or PEDSAFE. Conducting a site visit can give you a good idea of the site conditions in high priority locations. A road safety assessment is a type of site visit which formally engages many types of stakeholders that collaborate to document safety issues and recommend improvements for priority corridors. Alternatively, you can lead an informal site visit to observe conditions in the field. Step 4 helps you select appropriate countermeasures for locations identified in the prior three steps. To learn more about each of the countermeasures, visit the STEP website found on the resources page. Two tables provide an easy way to identify appropriate countermeasures for a specific location. The tables are based on safety research, best practices, and established national guidelines. Table 1, shown here, is a matrix of cells intended to provide initial countermeasure options based on roadway characteristics. Start with information about traffic speed and volume to find the correct column in the table. Then use the number of lanes and presence of median to find the applicable row. Where the row and column overlap in the matrix is where you will find the appropriate cell. Each cell identifies countermeasures that you can consider given these road conditions. Each number in the cell corresponds to a countermeasure that is a candidate treatment at a marked, uncontrolled pedestrian crossing location. A dark circle around a number means that the countermeasure should always be considered. Table 2 helps you find potential countermeasures based on the specific safety issues at the uncontrolled crossing. To use the table, find the safety issue you would like to address at the top of the table. Issues include conflicts at crossing locations, excessive vehicle speed, inadequate visibility or conspicuity, drivers not yielding to pedestrians in crosswalks, and insufficient separation from traffic. Each cell with the pedestrian icon beneath the safety issue corresponds to a countermeasure listed on the left that addresses that issue. To address multiple safety issues, find the rows where both issue cells have icons to locate the appropriate countermeasures. For example, if you have identified excessive vehicle speed and drivers not yielding to pedestrians in crosswalks as safety issues, you'd want to consider crosswalk visibility enhancements, in-street pedestrian crossing signs, and/or raised crosswalk. Once countermeasures have been selected, you can move to Step 5, consult local and national design and installation resources. The Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices, MUTCD, Chapter 4 provides detailed guidance on pedestrian control features and pedestrian hybrid beacons. You can also consult the MUTCD on signage and roadway markings for all countermeasures. The ASHDO Guide for the Planning, Design, and Operation of Pedestrian Facilities is another resource that describes the preferred design of pedestrian countermeasures. You can also review local policies and guidance for design and countermeasure installation. This review may highlight opportunities to improve local guidelines. Step 6 describes opportunities for funding, implementation, and monitoring outcomes after installation. Funding is a common challenge, particularly for local agencies. Local agencies may supplement local funds with federal funds through programs like the Highway Safety Improvement Program or state safety funding. It is also important to identify other opportunities for implementation, like incorporation of the countermeasure into roadway maintenance or traffic operation projects. Once improvements are constructed, it is important to monitor the results to convey the value of the investment in pedestrian safety countermeasures to community leaders and the public. You can set performance measures and plans, like a pedestrian safety action plan. The measures may be quantitative, such as the percent reduction in crashes, or qualitative, such as a measure of public support. Let's go through some examples to practice using the tables and selecting countermeasures to improve pedestrian safety at uncontrolled crossing locations. Consider the corridor shown. The road is 4 lanes, undivided, and serves approximately 19,000 vehicles per day. The speed limit on the corridor is 35 miles an hour. After analyzing the pedestrian crash history on the corridor, we find that 2 of 5 pedestrian crashes involved improper or illegal driver action, while 3 of 5 crashes occurred during daylight. Take a moment to remember or write down these details. Using the information provided, find the appropriate cell in Table 1. Which countermeasures should be considered for a crossing on the roadway? Given the traffic volume and speed, we need to look in this column. Following the row with 4+ lanes without a raised median, we find the two overlap in this cell. According to this table, countermeasures that should be strongly considered at a crossing on the roadway include an advanced yield here to pedestrian sign and yield line, a pedestrian refuge island, or pedestrian hybrid beacon. Other countermeasures you could consider include curb extensions or a road diet. Crosswalk visibility enhancements should always occur with any other countermeasure. Looking at the roadway a second time, which other features might we want to take into consideration? First, we see there is on-street parking, which can visually obstruct pedestrians at crossing locations. A crossing may need to be located a particular distance from the on-street parking, or some parking spaces may need to be moved to improve visibility and sight distance for pedestrians. Next, the presence of a bus indicates the presence of bus stops along the corridor. Providing a crossing location near a bus stop can help transit riders access their destination. Finally, we see that there is an intersection further down the road. Knowing the distance to the nearest intersection is important when deciding on a crossing location to ensure the crossing complies with local agency standards. Let's look at our example road after improvements were made. As a reminder, these were the improvements recommended in Table 1. We can see several of these improvements have been made. Most obvious is that the road has undergone a road diet from 4 travel lanes to 2 with a median. At the mid-block crossing shown, curb extensions bulb out around on-street parking, a high visibility crosswalk spans both lanes, and a pedestrian refuge island provides space for pedestrians to stop and look for oncoming traffic as they cross. An in-street pedestrian crossing sign has also been included, perhaps to address driver failure to yield or make the crossing more conspicuous. For example 2, we will review both Table 1 and Table 2. Consider the corridor shown. The road is 2 lanes, undivided, and serves approximately 7,500 vehicles per day. The speed limit on the corridor is 25 miles per hour. Looking at the pedestrian crash history on the corridor, we find that 3 of 6 pedestrian crashes involve driver failure to yield, while 3 of 6 crashes occur during daylight. Again, take a moment to remember or write down the details. Using the information provided, find the appropriate cell in the table. Which countermeasure should be considered for an uncontrolled crossing location? Given the traffic volume and speed, you will find the correct cell in the first column. Our road was 2 lanes undivided, so we find the 2 overlap in the indicated cell. According to Table 1, countermeasures that should be strongly considered at a crossing on the roadway are crosswalk visibility enhancements, such as high visibility crosswalk markings, parking restrictions on crosswalk approach, adequate nighttime lighting levels, and crossing warning signs. Other countermeasures that can be considered include a raised crosswalk, an in-street pedestrian crossing sign, curb extensions, or pedestrian refuge island. Now consider Table 2. Which countermeasure should be considered for a crossing on the roadway given our initial information? Let's consider the road's crash history. We were told that about half of the crashes involved driver failure to yield. That points us towards the column titled Drivers Not Yielding to Pedestrians in Crosswalks to Explore Potential Countermeasures. In this case, we also have preliminary countermeasure options from Table 1, which we can use to narrow down our selections from Table 2. Table 1 indicates the countermeasure that should always be considered for our example 2 crossing was crosswalk visibility enhancements. Looking at the table, we can find the crosswalk visibility enhancements that can address poor driver yielding and are also appropriate for our example street's roadway characteristics. Other countermeasures that address driver yielding and align with our Table 1 results include a raised crosswalk and an in-street pedestrian crossing sign. By combining our conclusions from Table 1 and Table 2, we can compile a preliminary list of countermeasures to consider for enhancing an uncontrolled pedestrian crossing on our example roadway. Our countermeasures include high visibility crosswalks, in-street yield signs, raised crosswalks, curb extensions, and parking restrictions near crossings. Note these tables are only the starting point for countermeasure selection. You should also consider other components such as local policies and guidance in selecting appropriate countermeasures. This section identifies several resources you can use to diagnose pedestrian safety issues and select appropriate countermeasures. There are several resources available to support you in selecting countermeasures to improve pedestrian safety. Click the related web links to access the resources. The first resource listed here is the information discussed in this video, the Guide for Improving Pedestrian Safety at Uncontrolled Crossing Locations. The FHWA Safe Transportation for Every Pedestrian, or STEP, program webpage contains detailed information about each pedestrian countermeasure, case studies, and links to additional resources. Ped Bike Safe hosts the Pedestrian Safety Guide and Countermeasure Selection System. It includes detailed information on each countermeasure, including a description, purpose, estimated cost, and case studies. There is also a countermeasure selection tool which provides appropriate countermeasures for a specific location based on the goal of the treatment and site characteristics. The final resource outlines how to develop and implement a pedestrian safety action plan as referred to in Step 1. A pedestrian safety action plan can lay the groundwork for all other steps discussed in this guide. Thank you for your interest in pedestrian countermeasure selection. We hope you've gained a better understanding of how to select appropriate countermeasures to improve pedestrian safety at uncontrolled crossing locations.